welcome to this RedMonk conversation. My name is Kelly Fitzpatrick, and with me today is Tom Johnson, CTO of Multiplayer and longtime developer. Tom, thank you for joining me on the Monkcast today.
Thanks for having me.
And Tom, to start things off, can you tell us a bit about who you are and what you do?
Sure. My name is Tom Johnson. I'm the co-founder and CTO of Multiplayer. My background is in software development for over 20 years. Got started in speech recognition and robotics, segued into telecom software, and then when the web became a thing, I worked on building large distributed systems for a number of small companies and large companies.
So you've been doing like totally easy things is what I'm hearing.
Yeah.
And so Multiplayer is a word that I have heard in many contexts. Like first and foremost, like gaming, like I'm a gamer. Like I have a book with a chapter on like MMORPGs. So like that's a word that I am familiar with. You have a company called Multiplayer. I want to hear more about the company and the name.
Sure. Yeah. So Multiplayer is a company that builds tools for teams that work on distributed systems. And for anybody who, designs, develops software these days, you know that you've got these really complex systems and you need a team to work on this stuff together. It's no longer a solo act, or it's really hard for it to be a solo act. So it's a team sport. And we thought the name Multiplayer was perfect for this, company that we started.
Yeah, and I like that. And I agree, like very few people are building things solo these days.
Right.
And so for folks out there who are not already familiar with RedMonk, our focus is on developers and other technical practitioners. We spend a lot of time talking about developer experience and tooling. One thing we've noticed is that building software today is just not the same as it was even a few years ago. Systems are more complex, developers are asked to do more and more. And while there is a cornucopia of developer tooling out there, navigating these choices and having to stitch or metaphorically duct tape them together often leads to what my colleague Steve O'Grady has called the developer experience gap. Tom, you have been in very technical roles for quite a long time. How have you seen things change for developers?
It's different than when I got started. So you could do so much on your own. Systems were a lot simpler. You'd have client server, you have two things, even before that, you just had desktop software, one thing. So now you have complex platforms that pull together microservices and apps and SaaS platforms and cloud. So you've got systems are more complex. They're also more dynamic, meaning they're changing more frequently. But on top of that, teams are different. It's no longer a solo hero developer that does all the things. You have specialists, DevOps, front-end developers, back-end developers, and even executives and managers are getting involved in the development of software. So it's changed radically since when I started.
Yeah, and I would say I have not been in the software industry as long as you, but I have seen it change drastically, even in the last 6 years that I've been an analyst, much less from when I was actually a practitioner running a test and a release team. The other thing that this blows my mind is the potential changes in the like onboarding of new developers to just the experience of building software today. It is just so drastically different than it was back when I started.
Sure. And, it's so much harder. If you're a developer coming into a new team, the first question you're going to ask is, okay, what is your software? And that's a tough question to answer. Documentation is probably spread out of date, you can no longer go to one person to answer the questions anymore. So it's really a challenge. And that's one of the things that we're looking to solve at Multiplayer, make that a lot easier.
I'm glad that you brought up documentation because it means I didn't have to do it. I'm also a former tech writer. So I tend to be like, let's talk about documentation. And folks are like, why are we talking about documentation? But you're already there. And I think that's relevant to a trend that we've been seeing in recent research on developer experience and productivity, which we've seen a lot more people talking about both of those things. In two areas that we see consistently cited as influential factors in determining developer experience are documentation and technical debt. Does that fit with what you are seeing?
Absolutely. So developer experience, I sort of think of that as like, how happy are your developers? How productive are they? And, it starts with like having clarity. Messages coming from above to say what you should be working on, clear focus, and to have a clear picture of like what you're working on, to understand the system. And a big part of that, as boring as it sounds, is having a source of truth, you know, up-to-date documentation about your system, and to not have to chase it, to not have to like put a lot of manual work in keeping it up to date. So, you know, we're trying to, you know, fix this problem by letting your system auto-document itself using open technologies. So we're hoping to solve this, take the manual work out of documentation, have a source of truth, and have a better developer experience as a result.
Yeah, I love that documentation that is not relying on a human necessarily doing it. Not that you don't want humans involved, but
right.
Especially at crunch time, documentation is one of those things that often gets dropped to the bottom of the list because there are other fires to put out, and it's something that we need nevertheless.
Sure. And it comes into play in different phases of development. So, you know, you want your source of truth to be the thing that you don't have to manually update, because nobody does it well. I mean, everybody's got horror stories about like the diagram that they updated a month ago and like it's out of date and all this sort of stuff. So you want your source of truth to be something that is sort of driven by your system. But, you know, you're right. There is still manual work. If you're designing something, you're choosing like what you intend to change. There's some documentation there. You need to communicate that. That can be a challenge as well.
Yeah, so follow-up question. You've recently written about the differences between system diagramming and system design, and we'll link to that article in the show notes. But one thing that caught my eye is your articulation that developers use diagrams as a form of communication. And you write, I'm going to quote this, "Developers often use diagrams to tackle a fundamental communication challenge, conveying the complexities of a distributed software system, including its components, dependencies, and APIs, clearly and effectively to a distributed team," end quote. And yet, as you argue, diagramming tools might not be the best way to communicate all of this complexity. Can you tell us more about this, especially for folks who have not had time to read your article yet?
Sure. So humans are visual by nature. You know, picture's worth a thousand words. With a complex system, it can be easiest to use sort of visual metaphors to communicate complex subtopics and ideas quickly. So the idea of visualization, great. Diagramming tools aren't built for system design. And system design incorporates more than just a picture. It's collaboration. It's knowing of what you're working on. You have a source of truth and not some outdated, you know, thing. You know, right now there's just manual work and sort of keeping that diagram up to date. You know, that's not, you don't want that to be part of your sort of design process. And on top of that, one of the things that you do in, you know, in a team is not just sort of look at a diagram for just informational purposes, but you're frequently debugging issues. And you need something that's like more interactive, more than just looking at a picture. So visualization is good, but diagramming leaves a lot to be desired. Doesn't solve a lot of the problems that developers and teams have.
Yeah, and I think in terms of diagramming, as we are creating a visual image, right, as opposed to we are collaboratively creating the map for a system, I think that's a slightly different thing.
Yes.
There, a slightly different project. And I feel like that lack of single source of truth that can kind of come out of it. Like you had mentioned, like, what is it like to like do a diagram and then see that it is updated a month later? I feel like I've done a diagram and it has been out of date the next day. So I feel like the feedback loops and the iteration cycles that we're seeing today, especially with the architectures that are like in vogue, are really not conducive to like static diagrams.
Absolutely. Static, I mean, the word static, it's not, you've got a dynamic environment with a dynamic team and a lot of things that are changing. That does not connect well to a static diagram that is in a file somewhere living and collecting dust, you know? So, you've got the different phases of development. You've got design, development, you know, deployment, and then the cycle of that happening. So you need something that is like source of truth, auto updated, takes the manual work out and allows you to change things. And developers need to see diffs and changes. You know, diagramming tools don't do that. You need to know what the intent is. If you're making a design, I want to know, if I have 1,000 components in my system, my feature probably changes one or two or three things. Maybe I'm adding a component, a new service, a new dependency, changing a couple API endpoints. I need to communicate that to people effectively. And diagramming tools just weren't built for that.
And then I also feel like anytime you're, even if you're changing just one or two or three things, the chances of you breaking something and then being able to find what broke.
Exactly.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah. Yeah. So in diagramming tools, as a lot of people know who've tried to use them for system architecture, there's a certain point where the number of components and the number of lines between things representing dependencies, just things break down. You no longer see what's connected to what. You no longer understand the dependencies and things. So answering the question, like, if I change this, what will break, is unanswerable, especially when it's not auto-updated. It's probably wrong. And what line is this again? And it's overlapping with these 50 other things. Like, it's just tough.
Yeah. So we've talked a bit about why developers need to start doing systems design instead of just diagramming. Any other thoughts on the types of tools that developers need in 2024 and beyond?
Sure. So, you need a tool that is auto-updating your source of truth, connected to your system, takes the manual work out of collecting and discovering and tracking your system, right? It takes the work out. So you can see visualizations as system architecture, you can see the APIs, you can see the dependencies, you can see all sorts of other things. And so, tooling that allows for that, then, you have something to work off of and you can trust. So that's one thing. The tool needs to be collaborative too. I mean, we see on Figma and the front end development, it's like the value of having a tool where people can come together and work together on the same stuff. It's no longer just like a database listing of like the services that I have in my platform, but it's an interactive set of documents that we can, work on together. That's important for the design phase. So the collaboration needs to be, distributed real time as source up to date. And, those are really important things for the tooling that for developers now and in the future.
And let's say someone or some team wants to follow your directive to stop diagramming and start designing and find some better tools to allow this. Any advice on adopting new tools? Because sometimes the overhead of switching tools can in itself be prohibitive.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, that's a great question because you have this sort of sunk cost fallacy where it's like, oh, I've got all these diagrams and I spend a lot of time on this. Let's just keep going in that direction. I would focus more on like the benefits of productivity and developer experience, developer happiness by abandoning the manual, out of date, troublesome current way of documenting and debugging, and use a tool that removes the manual work, immediately increases the developer experience, and just embrace that for the future. That is the future. It's we are transitioning from manually updated system documentation to auto updated with lots of other tooling built around that. You might as well embrace it now. Get the developer hours back, get a little happiness up, just do it.
I am all for anything that increases developer happiness. So I think that's a good aim and maybe worth putting in the time to bring in a tool that maybe can help with that.
Sure.
So we are about out of time, but before we go, Tom, how can folks hear more from you? Where can folks find you on socials? And are you doing any more speaking we should know about?
So you can find me on X or Threads as Tom Johnson 3, that's the number 3 at the end, or on LinkedIn as Thomas Johnson. Also, you can find out more about Multiplayer at multiplayer.app, and we're Try Multiplayer on the social platforms. And, you know, I've got some podcasts coming up. I'm sure we'll post details about that on our site. I love doing podcasts, and I'll be at a couple shows too that we'll probably promote on the site.
Well, Tom, we have loved having you on our podcast. So thank you again for joining us.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
And again, my name is Kelly Fitzpatrick with RedMonk. If you enjoyed this conversation, please like, subscribe, and review the Monkcast on your podcast platform of choice. If you are watching YouTube, please like, subscribe, and engage with us in the comments.